morning. We know that we can't actually meet here in our building, but you're going to get to participate with us today in our service. All right, so what you got to tell your parents is to take a picture of you participating in our service today, put the picture on our Facebook feed, and you will get a prize if at a random drawing at AWC when we can join together again. So make sure you have your parents take pictures of you enjoying the service this morning. All right, let's get started. Brother Joe, what are you doing? Are you okay?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm doing well. What are you doing?
I'm trying to eat. I've been cooped up for days.
Yes, you have. What are you wearing? And what is that?
This is my deluxe sushi meal. While they've been stuck in their house, I've been stuck in the belly of a whale. I can't believe it. I've been stuck in the belly of a whale. And all I've had to eat is sushi. And I have some, some uneaten sardine.
Oh.
Hey, Steve, you want to bite?
No, I don't want to bite.
Why not? They're pretty good.
They don't want to bite either.
Hey, you want to bite? Hey, you ought to go have a challenge and go tell your mom and dad to buy you some sardines.
No, oh, man. Sardines, are they good? Reverend John, you better put that down. Okay.
Can you hold that for me just for a second?
I'm gonna hold it over here for
you. Woo! Oh man. I've been stuck in a whale for 3 days. And
you've
so
been
it's
stuck
like,
where?
In a whale.
Ooh.
Yeah, I've been stuck. Man, this is stinky.
You stink.
This is horrible.
Why have you been stuck?
Well, because you know, God told me to go to the people of Nineveh and and I told him, no, I don't think so. I'd rather eat sardines in the belly of a whale.
You would rather eat those sardines?
Those people are mean. They're ugly. They're rude. Oh. They use bad words.
John.
And they're so mean and ugly. They're horrible. I cannot believe that God would love them. That God loves them, and he told me to go tell them that he loves them. And no way. They're ugly. I mean, look at this. Look how pathetic. I was in that whale, and look, I got all tangled up in this stuff.
I stink.
Well, that's probably because of what I've been swimming in. Have you ever seen the inside of a fish?
No.
Have you ever caught a fish? Oh, man, it's terrible. But anyway, God told me, and I told him no. I took off running. So,
you told God no?
Yeah, you tell God no. No, you ever never told God no?
No.
Oh, man, I tell you what.
I don't need to tell God no.
Yeah. Well, so I got on a boat and we ended up in a storm. So they threw me overboard and got swallowed by a fish and now I can't get out of it.
Oh, yeah, you're having trouble there.
So,
you stink so bad.
Is that you or me?
No, that's you.
I think that's you.
Oh, that's awful. Okay, continue. I
want to
hear the rest of the story.
So God told me to go tell him that he loves him. Okay. I said, no, I don't think so.
No.
I don't think so. No. Because God can't love somebody that mean and that bad.
Yes.
No, they can't. Does God love mean people? No, I don't think so. God does not.
Brother John, don't tell them that.
Well, you know, we've been studying about how when you talk mean and you act and you say bad words, what do you sound like? A pig. You sound like a pig. We talked about that. We talked about how when you're rude and you're mean and you don't do what God tells you.
Yeah.
When we talked about Moses, how God told him to speak to the rock instead of striking it.
Right.
What happened? He got so mad. He went,
"Aah!" He lost his temper.
Mm-hmm. Then we talked about David and Goliath and how Goliath was saying mean words.
Right.
And then God told Jonah to go to Nineveh and tell them that he loves them no matter their sin. And I told God, no, I don't think so. I don't think so. No way. God cannot love somebody that much.
Oh, yes,
that he would tell them that he loved them. I mean, they said bad words about him. They cussed it. They used bad words.
Well, yes, but they need Jesus too.
Well, they might.
They might,
but let somebody else go tell them. They're mean. They're like kind of like the bullies at school and how when you see those bullies at school, they look at you and go, "You look funny.
Yeah.
Oh, your hair is ugly. Oh, you dress funny. Oh." And all that.
Yeah.
Well, God told me to go down there and tell them and to use kind words and to tell them that Jesus loves them, that God loves them.
Well, then you should listen and go. They need to know about the Lord too, just like these boys and girls.
Well, yeah, they might, but they're not that bad. They ain't bad like those people. Those people were horrible. And so they had, God told them to go tell Jonah, can't even talk, go tell the Ninevites that Jesus, God, I love them. That I love them and that I care for them.
Yes.
And I cannot believe that God would do something like that. And you know what? He does love us, but I just don't know if we can do that.
I think you better listen. Because God loves those people too.
Well,
just
he
like
might,
these boys and girls.
Yeah, yeah. You know what, boys and girls? No matter what you may be facing in life, and no matter what problems may come your way, God loves you, and God loves the world out there, and the people out there, and the children out there that may even say bad words to you or say mean things to you, because guess what? God loves everyone. And God cares about them. So what we got to do, now I know over the next couple weeks you might not see all your friends, so you might just see your family, your friends, and they might get on your nerve just a little bit. And so practice using kind words with your family. Practice saying, oh man, you look awesome. Oh, don't touch him. Practice telling, hey, you look nice today from 6 feet. Hey, you look cool. Hey, that's a nice hairdo.
That would be nice.
Be practice now, so that way when you get to go back to school or whatever you go, when you get to go out and play with a few friends, hey, guess what? You can practice using those kind words like Jonah did. And guess what? When Jonah went and told Nineveh that God loved them, even though they was bad, guess what the Ninevites did? They ask God to forgive them of their sins. So all it takes is someone like you to tell that mean person, guess what? God loves you. And guess what? God can change their life, Sister Christy.
That's
God can
right.
help them. But when we use kind words, but guess what won't help them?
What?
When you say, oh, well, you look ugly too. And your mama looks funny too. And when you're mean back to them, guess what they say? I don't want to be around them. I can't hang around them. So guess, boys and girls, I challenge you this week, while you're in the house and not in the belly of the whale, and you still stink, not me. And when you're at home with your family and your friend, or not with your friends, maybe a couple friends, but you're at home with your family, practice using kind words. Practice being nice, because guess what, boys and girls? Jesus loves them people too. Jesus loves everyone, and you gotta show them, and you had to show them with your kind words. And so James 1:19, well, the scripture we've been learning about, it says, if I can remember now, it says, be slow to speak, quick to listen, and slow to anger. In other words, listen. Remember, we got to listen more than we talk. We have two ears and one mouth for a reason. So if you can listen and speak, and don't get mad, just let God shine through, and you can be a light to your world. So I'm glad that you joined us this morning, and I'm sorry we can't be together, but hey, we had fun, and I'm going to do a quick game with you, okay? So I want to challenge you to a game, all right? Can you do this with me? All right. Brother John is going to show you a game that you can do at home with your whole family. All you got to do is have a phone and a stopwatch, okay?
Right.
So you can have a bat. If you don't have a bat, you can get a broomstick or any kind of pole, or you really don't even have to have, you can just have anything you want there, okay? So you grab the bat,
okay?
You grab the bat, mm-hmm. and then what you had to do is you had to set up kind of like an obstacle course. So get your blanket or in your living room, put some dining room chairs up, and where you can run around the table, and have just a lot of fun, and you can challenge your mom and dad to do it too. So what you gotta do is you gotta take this, and you gotta spin around in a circle 10 times.
No,
okay?
Not 10.
Yeah.
They're gonna get real dizzy.
Yeah, well, the kids can do it 10, adults can do it 5, and Brother John's going to do it 3. So Brother John don't fall over when he runs. So that's the best thing. Okay, so you kids have to do it 10 times, and you have to get your mom and dad to do it 10 times, but Brother John, he may do it 5 just to be...
Okay.
I think you ought to do it.
No, I'll let you. I'm going to set the timer.
Okay, so you're going to time me. And I made a little obstacle course over here, so I'm going to run over there, go out, and she's going to see all how right. fast. So I want to challenge you to do it. All right, see if you can beat Brother John. All right, are you ready? Here we go. You got to give me... Okay, you got it.
On your mark. Get set, go!
I can't breathe, it stinks in here! 1, 2, it smells like sardines in the belly of a whale! Where am I at?
You're at 5, go!
At 5? Okay. Woo!
Hurry, hurry, hurry! 17 seconds! Good job!
I can't breathe. Oh, that was a lot of fun. Hey, there's a blanket. So boys and girls, if you want to repost that of you doing it and your family, you can repost it if you want, or tell me how much fun you had. But we're so glad you joined us this morning. We're going to say a quick prayer for you and your family and everyone that watches this, that God will be with you today. Lord, we love you. We thank you for these awesome children. We want you to be with us over this next week. God, we want you to help us to speak kind words to our family, to our friends. Lord, be with us this week. Touch us and let us have a great day today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Bye.
I can't breathe.
I love you.
I'm out of breath. It stinks.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to AWC Online on a Sunday morning. We're so excited that you've chose to join in today, wherever that may be, on a couch in your living room, gathered around the dining room table. We know that God is going to move into your home today, touch you and your family, and we're just believing for a tremendous presence of the Lord to fill whatever edifice that you are in today. Even though we can't physically gather together, I believe that God has given us this medium for this time so that he can touch us all individually. As we worship together today with a couple of songs and as we look into the Word of God, I pray that you would open yourself up and tune out all of the distractions that you may have around you and just focus in, just like you would if you were sitting here in this sanctuary that right now is empty because you're at home. I know that God can touch you and God can do a great thing. I would ask that you would remember your Sunday morning tithes and offerings. You've always been so generous in giving to the work of God, and we pray that you would continue to do so even when you can't physically bring your offerings to this place. You can give online by clicking the link that's on your screen right now, and I know that God will bless you for that. Remember different things that are happening throughout the week. All extracurricular activities are closed here at AWC, but we will be gathering online this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock for another great live Bible study with Pastor Borders, and then again next Sunday at 10 a.m. Our youth are going to be hanging out on the Zoom app this tonight at 6 o'clock. So if your teenagers want to be a part of that, make sure you go and search the App Store on your device for Zoom, and more information will be provided for them on how to connect to all of that. Monday night, 4:30 to 6:30 p.m., we're going to be doing drive-through prayer. We believe that God can touch. Restaurants may be closed, but their drive-throughs are open. So the church can open our drive-thru too. And so we're going to pray as for whoever would want to stop by. We may not be able to come in physical contact. We may have to keep a little distance there, but we'll have prayer cloths that will be anointed. And if there's a need in your body or somebody you know that you would want to send by the church Monday evening from 4:30 to 6:30, our ministry team will be here praying for whoever wants to come through the parking lot. And I believe God's going to bless those efforts today. Now, we're going to enter into a time of worship here, and we're going to sing some songs together. Maybe you want to get up from where you're at, maybe on the couch or on the table, and maybe you just want to stand up and be where you can lift your hands and maybe pace around, set the device up where you can see it somewhere. The lyrics are going to be on the screen for you to sing along with. But why don't you turn your home into a worshipful environment right now? I feel the Holy Ghost already beginning to move. Could we lift our hands and our voices, and could we pray that God would touch us today as we worship Him? Jesus, we need a moving of Your Spirit, God, wherever we are. God, whatever emotions and feelings we may be facing at this moment, as time has not allowed for us to come together today, I know, Lord, that Your presence is with us and that You will meet with us, God. As a church body, as a family, as we pray for our city today, Lord, I'm asking that You would give our leaders wisdom. I'm praying, Lord, that You would touch our communities, that You would bring healing to everybody that needs healing, God, and protect us. But Lord, more than just protect us, use us in this time to be a light and a witness in the world that we are living in. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's worship together today.
Miracles happen when You move. Healing come and do what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Set our hearts on you. Come and do what you do. 'Cause we need a move. We need a move.
Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Amen. I think it would be appropriate at this point in our Sunday morning service. It's a custom around here. We pray every Sunday morning for our families. And I think we would be amiss to not do that here again today. Because as you sit in your home, gathered there with your family, you need God to touch. As you've got those children pulled up around you, or maybe they're listening from a spot on the floor, I believe that God is touching them, and God's going to move in your home today. So if you're with your family and you can, I wonder if you could just pull them a little closer and get their attention right now. And could we pray together? If you're by yourself, that's okay. Go ahead and just lift your voice and pray over your home. Pray over your family that may not be present with you right now. And let's ask God to touch our homes. Jesus, we love you today. And God, while the world may seem like it's in chaos and confusion, we know, Lord, that you are not confused and you are not surprised. But God, you have the whole world in your hands, and you have our families for sure in your hands. We pray today, Lord, that you would touch every home. God, every mother, every father, every grandmother, every grandfather, God, let them feel the presence of the Lord today. Every child, son and daughter, God, every grandchild today, I pray, Lord, that you would touch them and move upon their homes. God, during these perilous times, God, I pray that there would be peace that would come over the home. I pray, Lord, that there would be a feeling, God, of security and your presence that would move upon our families right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Have your way in our homes, Lord, right now. Amen, amen, amen. God is good. We're thankful for his presence and his touch in our lives. I know that this may be a different format, but God is surely in this place, and he's surely where you are right now, and God's going to touch us today. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to read today from the Old Testament book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter number 19, verses 11 through 13. This is the story of Elijah, and he has run from Jezebel, who said she's going to kill him. And now he's seen a lot of great things. He's the prophet of God, been used of God, but now he runs for his life and he finds himself in a cave. And the Bible says in 1 Kings 19 and 11 that the Lord told Elijah to go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and break in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still, small voice. And it was so that when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entering in of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, what doest thou here, Elijah? What doest thou? Lord, there's all this stuff going on, all these things that are happening that I'm seeing with my eyes. There's a whirlwind and there's a earthquake and there's fire. And God, I'm looking for you in the mix of all of this. I'm looking for you, but I don't see you there. Today, for a few moments, I want to talk to you on this thought. It's really a question, simply this, is where is God in the mix? Where is God in the mix? Could we close our eyes one more time and pray that the Lord would help us? Jesus, we're so thankful for your presence that we feel right now. And the word, the Lord, you are about to bring to us, I pray that it would direct our homes and it would guide us and keep us, God. Help us, Lord, in spite of all that we're facing and all that we're experiencing, God, to see you and to find you. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Now, this vase right here is very important to me and my wife. It was during our wedding ceremony a little over 13 years ago that this vase was empty, and it was filled up during our wedding ceremony. It was an element that involved pouring colored sand into the vase. And as we came down into the altar. It was our way of saying that we wanted to include God into our marriage. So as the ceremony went on, the very first layer of sand was white. It represented God. That this marriage, that this home was going to be founded upon God and upon His principles. The black sand was mine, the green sand was my wife's, and we poured in on top of that foundation simultaneously, mixing our two lives together, the two colors of sand that would be built upon the foundation of God and Him being the chief cornerstone. After some of that was mixed in, there was the middle layer of white sand that was put, representing that God was going to be in the middle of it all, that as life went on, as life carried on, that God was still going to be included in that. And then another layer of the black and green sand mixing our lives around. And then the top layer again was white, showing that God was going to bookend both sides of our life, that He was going to be a part in the beginning, in the middle, at the end, all throughout. God was going to be a part of our home. Now, I don't know if you can see it from the angle that you're looking at it. Maybe I can include a picture of the top of it, but there's not a completely white covering now. In fact, most of it's green, which is my wife's color, so that might give you a clue as to the kind of relationship we have. I don't know how it happened, how the white sand that was on top shifted away so much. Maybe we didn't get enough white sand on the top. This has only been transported 3 times. It got transported from the church where we had our wedding to the home, our first home, and then it got transported from our first home to our new home, and then I brought it over here today. And each time it's been done with ginger care, holding it in somebody's lap, driving very slowly and carefully, making sure that we don't slide the contents around. But I noticed not long after we got married, as I walked by this vase, that the sand had begun to shift. And there was not as much God on top there as I had originally thought that there was going to be. This sits in our bedroom now on our dresser. And I noticed just a few weeks ago, I noticed, babe, there, all that sand has been shifted around. What happened? It hasn't moved around. And she said, well, your daughter, Eden, our 3-year-old, she climbed up on the laundry basket the other day and she had stuck her hand down inside and she was swirling that sand around. And my wife stopped her because this is very important to us. I don't know how it got here. We didn't mean for it to. We had good intentions, right? That we were going to build our home upon the foundation of God. But now in the middle of all that is happening, it's kind of shifted a little bit and it doesn't seem to look like it once did. Isn't it amazing how quickly that life can change and that things can turn around? It's so easy to get caught up in life and before we know it, things have completely shifted around. Our world has become mixed up, different than what it once was, different than what we intended for it to look like. This is what our world has come to. We didn't mean for it to. We had good intentions, but now in the swirling mess of the mixed emotions, we're trying to locate God. Where did He go? There's a little sand, white sand over here, and there's a little white sand over here. He was just there, I promise. He was right there. I know that we added Him to the mix. I know that we had Him there. I know that we put Him all throughout from beginning to the middle to the end. But now I'm seeing less and less of Him in the mix of life. And the shifting sands of time have us wondering, where is God? This isn't what we thought was going to happen. This isn't what we thought it was going to look like. This isn't how we imagined life turning out, and somehow we can't locate God in the mix of the shifting sands of time. I wonder how the prophet Elijah felt. He's just called fire down from heaven as he confronted the prophets of Baal and saying, let the true Jehovah God, the one true God, let him answer by fire. And so obviously he stands up and he does everything, and there's this fire from heaven that falls and licks up the sacrifice and all that is given there. And Elijah's on this high. Yeah, God is good. God answers by fire. He's feeling pretty good about the power and the authority that he has with God. He prays immediately following that. He prays that the Lord would send the rain in the middle of the drought. And he goes to the top of the mountain and he sends his servant, "Go and look into the skies and tell me what you see." And his servant said, "I see a cloud the size of a man's hand." And before long, there's a deluge of rain as God begins to answer the prayers of Elijah. 1 Kings 18 and 46 tells us that the hand of the Lord was on Elijah. Wow, I got God's hand on me. I got God touching me. I got God using me in miraculous ways. What a privilege this is. What an honor this is for God to use me in this way. But two short verses later, Elijah's life gets mixed up. For 1 Kings chapter number 19, verses 2 and 3 tells us that Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah saying, "So let the gods do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." She said, "Elijah, I'm going to kill you. You caused the prophets of Baal to die. You caused my God to be humiliated. I'm going to kill you." And Elijah, when he saw that, he arose and the King James Version says he went for his life. He began to run for his life. I thought things were going good. I thought God was touching. I thought God's hand was on me. But now I'm running for my life. I'm hiding. I'm trying not to get caught up in the mix of all that is happening and all that is taking place. The man who was on top of the world is running for his life. 1 Kings 19 and 9 says that he came thither unto a cave and he lodged there. Elijah had just come out of a fiery revival and now he's isolated in a cave. Sound familiar? Just last week we gathered every night believing that God was going to touch and God was going to move, and what tremendous move of God we had. But now we're isolated. Now we're apart. Now we can't come together. Understand how Elijah feels. I think we can share his emotions when we realize that what we thought was how it was going to happen and how God was going to move is not how it works now. It's not the same way we imagined. And we're looking in the crazy mixed up times that we're in, and we're wondering, where is God in the mix? And the Lord comes to Elijah and he asks him, "What are you doing here?" Elijah, in this cave, in this place where you are, what are you doing? Why are you here? That's a question you and I might want to consider over the next few days, as we are where we are in our homes and in our separated from everybody else, wondering, where is God? Maybe we need to ask the question, what am I doing here? In this moment, in this place where life looks a little bit different, in this moment when it's not the way that I thought it was going to go, what am I doing here? Am I just going to let time slip away? Am I going to just isolate and hope for the best? Will I lose God in the mix of all that is going on? Or are we going to take this time to say, "God, I'm pursuing you. God, I'm coming after you. I'm longing for your presence, Lord." Elijah answered the question by declaring, God, I've been faithful. God, I've been willing servant, a willing vessel, but now I'm all alone and I'm all by myself." Excuse me. Where are you, God? What is happening in my life? And Where's God in the mix? Where are the others who were so faithful to the cause? Why am I by myself now? Why am I here all alone? What's going on, Lord? So God speaks to Elijah and he tells him, I want you to go out and I want you to stand before the Lord. Because understand this, all that Elijah needed to get renewed for service was a fresh vision of the power and of the glory of God. That's what we need. We need a fresh vision of the power and the glory of God. It's so easy to get caught up in the news. It's so easy to get caught up in what social media would tell us, that we have lost sight of the vision of the power and of the glory of God. It's time we get a fresh vision. It's time we take a fresh look and say, God, I want to see you. God, I want to know you. I want to experience you. God, help me to see you in the middle of all that is happening in my world. Help me to acknowledge you. So first the Lord causes a great wind to come by, and a wind so strong that it broke the rocks and it tore the mountain that Elijah was on, and there was no divine message for the prophet from God. There was no word. There was no presence of the Lord that could be seen or sensed by Elijah there. He had no idea what was going on, no idea what was taking place. And then the Lord comes after the wind, after the whirlwind that has caused confusion and it's mixed things up and it's turned things around. He brings a great earthquake that shakes the mountain that Elijah is residing in, but nothing from God came out of the earthquake. The Lord then brings a fire down, begins to light up everything that is around Elijah, but it too gave Elijah no message from the Lord. God, what is happening in the mix of it all? In the whirlwind and in the earthquake that is shaking and in the fire that is consuming. Where are you, God? What's happening here? Why can't I find my way, and why do I feel so alone? And after this dramatic display, there is a still, small voice. And when the prophet heard that voice, he stepped out of the cave and he met God. In the quiet, in the solitude, even though the world around him had just moments before been reeling, spinning about, shaking and burning up, in the stillness, he felt and heard the presence of God. And even though the mighty power and the great noise of the previous exhibitions didn't stir Elijah, that still small voice began to speak, and he recognized, that's the voice of God. That's the voice of the one I love. That's the voice of the one I serve. I'm not surrounded by the faithful. I'm not surrounded by those I gather with on a regular basis and then I'm accustomed to coming together with. I don't know where they are. I'm in the mix of everything, but even in the mix, I found God. I found his presence. I found his voice. And he's still speaking to me. He's still speaking. What some of us need to do in this period of chaos and mixed up feelings is simply listen for the voice of God. Maybe things have slowed down just a little bit because you don't have the busy schedule to attend to. Maybe things have quieted down, and if you would just turn off the mix that is going on in your brain of all the emotions and all the feelings, and you would just quiet yourself in this moment where you have no excuse not to, maybe God would speak to you in a way that he's never spoken to you before. You're looking at the whirlwind, and you're looking up at the mixing up of our world right now, and you're looking for God, and it just seems that he's hard to find. But the Lord says, quiet. quiet your mind, quiet your soul, and listen to my voice. As you read on through that 19th chapter of the book of 1 Kings, you'll learn that as the Lord continued to speak to Elijah, he gave him some instructions. He said, first, I want you to go back to Damascus. I want you to go back to the place where I called you to serve, the place I called you to be. And he says, I want you to locate three people, Elijah. He said, I want you to anoint two kings and a prophet. I want you to find them. I want you to lay your hands upon them. And I want you to bring them into your life. He's to prepare for the future that is ahead by anointing two kings and a prophet. 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 15 through 16 tells us that the Lord said unto him, go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shalt thou anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. Elijah, you need to get three perspectives attached to your life. There's three people that have three perspectives of God in the mix of it all, in the craziness of it all, that you need to find and that you need to get a part of your life. He said, first person I want you to find is I want you to find Hazael. And I want you to anoint him to be king over Syria. Syria is a Gentile nation, but the Lord still had a say in who was king. Wasn't necessarily a kingdom of God's people. It was simply a people that listened to his voice. You see, Hazael means seer of God. That's what his name means. He said, Elijah, I want you to go find Hazael, and I want you to make him king over a people that are not my children. I want you to go find the one who sees me, who sees in the spirit realm, and I want you to make him the authority over someone who is not submitted to the Lord. You see, you've been struggling to find God in the mix. You've been struggling on how to locate him and how to get him involved in your life. You've been staring through the whirlwind, but you've been unable to see him. You need to connect yourself with a man who is a seer of God. Somebody that can connect you to the Spirit of God. During this season where you and I are now practicing social distancing, where we're not able to come together, maybe it would be good if we took the time to tap into the Spirit of God. Maybe you could reach out to somebody that you haven't talked to in a while, somebody here that may have once sat across the aisle from you in a pew across the way, but you know they have a connection with the Spirit of God. Maybe you want to reach out to them during this time and say, help me get a fresh perspective. Help me to be able to see the way that God sees things. Help me to look at what is happening around me. And when I can't see them in the whirlwind, and when I can't see them in the shaking of the earth, and when I can't see him and the all-consuming flame, help me to locate the Spirit of God. Help me to find him. Help me to hear him. I want to find him. Oh, right where you are, I feel the Holy Ghost right now. As somebody that's been distant from him, somebody that's been separated from him. You've got a longing in your spirit. There's been something stirring inside of you, an anxiousness all week long that you've been wanting him. You've been wanting to feel him. And you want God to touch you right now. I want you just to lift your voice right where you're at and pray, God, help me to see you. Help me, God, to see things in the Spirit as I've never seen before. Help me, God, to sense your stirring and to sense your moving, God, even in the mix of it all. In the mix of all that is taking place, God, help me to see you. The second person that God told Elijah to find was a man by the name of Jehu. And he said, I want you to go and anoint him king over Israel. Jehu means Jehovah is he. He said, I want you to remember, Elijah, That when you feel like you're all alone, and when you feel like nobody is around and you can't find God, you just remember this. God is still God. He's still in control. He still has all power. He still has all authority. He still reigns above it all. Even when it looks like God has been surprised, remember that God has not been surprised, that it hasn't snuck up on God. He's still in control of it all. The psalmist said in Psalms 46 and 10, be still and know that I am God. Sometimes you just got to stop and remind yourself, He's still God. He's still powerful. He's still mighty. He's still faithful. He's still true. In the middle of it all, I know He's still my God that reigns above it all. And Elijah, you came all the way out here to this cave because you thought you were all alone, but don't you forget that I'm still the God that fed you with ravens. I'm still the God that sent fire down upon an altar on that mountaintop. I'm still the God who sent rain upon a dry and a thirsty land. I'm still the God, Elijah, that sent ravens to bring you meals. I'm still the God that told the angels to prepare you meals while you were sleeping. I'm still the God that has all power and dominion and authority. Don't you forget it, Elijah. Jehovah is He. He's still the God who reigns. Finally, the Lord looked at Elijah and He says, I want you to go find a young man by the name of Elisha, and I want you to make him the prophet in your room. I want you to get him, and I want you to train him, and I want you to equip him. But Elisha's name means God is my salvation. He said, Elijah, don't you forget it. Even in the cave, when you don't know what's going on and you can't seem to find God in the mix of it all, that I am the salvation of the whole world. I'm still the God who is mighty to save. I believe the Holy Ghost has brought you to this live stream today to hear the word of the Lord that would remind you that God is still your salvation. God is still your hope. He's the only eternal one who's able to save your soul. Maybe you've been feeling the void and you've been feeling the distance and you've been wondering what is going on in the mix of all of this and where is God and where all there are the answers. Can I tell you today, sir, ma'am, whoever you may be, that God knows exactly where you are. He loves you. He loves you so much that He died for you and He offered to us eternal salvation. All you got to do is repent of your sins, telling God, I'm sorry, please forgive me, and turning away from the old way of living and say, God, I'm going to follow a new path and I'm going to follow after you. You can be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of those sins. We have water here, and if you would like to be baptized, please reach out and contact us. We'd be glad to meet you here and baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of all of those sins. And then God said, if you'll repent and be baptized, that you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is unto you and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Let me tell you, God has not forgotten you. You are not alone, and He will save your soul. Don't lose God in the mix of it all. Don't lose God as the shifting sands of time carry on. Remember that He's still the God that is here. And He loves you. Would you close your eyes with me right now? And could we pray together that God would touch us today? Jesus, we're thankful, Lord, for your touch and for your presence. God, that you have touched us today and you have spoken your word to us. I pray, Lord, that you would come into every home and into every heart of every viewer, every hearer today of your word. And God, let it be something that would spring up inside of us. Let your spirit flow freely. Let it flow deeply within us, God. And let the power of the Holy Ghost be felt as you intend. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen, amen. I feel the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost right now. We're going to stay together for just a few moments longer. They're going to sing another song. And as they do, I wonder, would you take time to pray right where you are? Maybe you want to kneel down at the seat. Maybe you want to get up and walk around your home. But I believe it would be in order if we took a few moments to pray together and ask God to touch and to cover. Let's pray for our nation. Let's pray for our city. Let's pray for our church. Pray for those that you didn't get to see physically today, and pray that God would touch your home. If you're in need of prayer and want somebody to pray with you, please feel free to call the church at 405-329-1285 or email us online and pray that God, we pray that God would richly bless you. We love you. In Jesus' name, would you lift your voice and let's pray together.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. But it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you.
All about you. It's all about you.